churches. I really want to emphasize this. We're going to move through this quickly, but this is the last of the seven churches, and then next week we'll do probably a Father's Day thing more, and then the week after that we'll finalize the whole thing on the churches. So next week will probably be more about fathers and Father's Day, and then we have a lot of, it's interesting, we've had all these different event days, you know, this time of year. It seems like they kind of all fall in the spring and in early summer, but then we've got the 4th of July coming up, and you know, on and on it goes. So praise God for that. So let's, letters to the churches are reviewed. Let's go through that first. Remember Ephesus? And the reason I'm doing, I want you to hear what I'm saying about each one of these churches. In Ephesus, they were known for laboring hard and not fainting and separating themselves from the wicked. But they were admonished because they were doing it for the wrong cause. They were doing it as a political cause, in a sense. They weren't doing it for, because he said they forsook their first love. They were forsaking their first love. They were doing the stuff, but and that's good. It's good to do the stuff. It's good to apply yourself, but it's good to remember why you're doing it. And the promise to the church, he who has an ear, let him hear. And this is so important to hear. This is God, this is Jesus speaking to the people in the church today as well as he was speaking to them then. He says, he who has ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of paradise of God. That means we get to go back to living eternally. And he says, to those who overcome. This is not a mild, passive thing that we're doing. Christianity is, you know, it's turned into kind of a church thing, a social thing, but it's not that. You know, what we're going to do this Friday down in the middle of the square in Plattsmouth, and Randy, you don't know, but this is battle. This is spiritual battle. They've just announced, I don't know if you know it, but the lady that comes helps us with the Christmas tree, Carolyn, she says, I'm out of town. I'm moving out of Dodge. I'm getting out of Dodge. And I said, why? And she said, well, they finally have gone over the edge. And I said, what do you mean? And she said, well, they've just rented a building or sold a building to an organization that's going to be the place of paranormal. It's in the basement of the museum. Is that where it's going to be? Yeah. It's going to be in the basement of the museum of Plattsmouth. It's going to be, it's already there. It's a place of paranormal. They tore out the floor and it's just dirt or whatever, I don't know. Like a haunted house? Yeah. Yeah, so there's going to be a 24/7, there's going to be a 24/7 haunted house, but it's to experience the paranormal. And I don't know, you don't know the history of Plattsmouth or anything like that, but there used to be tunnels under the city and a lot of demonic activity, a lot of demonic worship, and I don't know if you know that or not, but there's a history of that. Lynn's husband, Jerry, had actually been down in him when he was working with air conditioning and stuff. He said he ended up in one of the tunnels and didn't realize where he was, and it's one church I spoke at the church in Minneapolis, and the guy knew nothing in Plattsmouth. He didn't know anything at all. He was one of the board members of the church. He was an executive for Cabela's, and what? Yeah, Jeremy, you want to go help him? And he's an executive at Cabela's, and I didn't know anything about the guy. I didn't know this about the guy at all before I asked about it. But he came up to me and he says I don't know what to tell you. He says I couldn't sleep all night knowing that you were coming. And I said, well, what do you mean? And he said, I just had this awful reoccurring nightmare all night long that there was like a porthole to hell in your city and that the demons just kept coming out of it like it was a place that came, that they were free to travel in and out. So I don't know if you know the history of this city. But I said, can you describe it to me? And he says, I just ran. He said, it was in a restaurant. It was in an old, like a greasy spoon restaurant downtown Plattsmouth on the main street. And he didn't know Plattsmouth, he didn't know Main Street, he'd never been there. And he described it exactly where the cafe was. And he described the room that they were coming out of. And then he said, but the strangest thing is, he says, I don't know anything about your town, But they began to chase me because I was crying out the name of Jesus, and they began to chase me. And he says, I ran. And he said, I'm embarrassed to say, but I ran. He said, I ran down the what appeared to be a main street in the city. He said, I ran out of the cafe, ran down a main street in the city. Now, you understand, this guy is an executive. I mean, he's not some kind of kook. He's never had anything like this happen before. I'm speaking at their church in Minnesota. And I said, well, what did you do? He says, well, it was the oddest thing. He says, I ran down the main street, but when I got to the end of Main Street, there was a river. And he said, I couldn't go anywhere. So I turned around, I came back, and he said, I found a bridge, and I crossed the bridge over the river into what I think was another state. And he described all that. And afterwards, I asked the pastor, I said, is this guy for real? And he says, yeah, he's on my board. He's a very well-respected man. He's an executive at Cabela's. They have a big operation up in their city, at Cabela's, in the city up there in Owatonna, Minnesota, is the name of the city. And I'm like, this is wild. I mean, he saw this. He says, I don't know what to tell you. He says, I don't know what to tell you, but pray against the enemy. Pray against the enemy. So there's a history in our city, and I don't know if you know that history. And that's not to scare anybody or give glory to the devil. But I don't know if you're familiar with a couple guys that went around the country. Their names were Lewis and Clark. Have you ever heard of Lewis and Clark? And you think of them as the guys that discovered the whatever. They were commissioned by George Washington to go throughout the country. What you don't know about them is that, and I got this from a Plattsburgh historian, but what you don't know about them is that they didn't go innocently around like you think that they went innocently around. They went throughout the United States, and at every mouth of every river, every confluence where one river went into another river, they did this Masonic ritual where they built an altar and burned sacrifices to the Mason God, whatever that is. You know, in America, Masonry is connected with Christian churches, but in India, it's connected to the Hindu churches. In Arab countries, it's connected to the Muslim countries. It's not a Christian organization. I don't know if you know that or not. But I was told that the smoke teepee where they did these sacrifices, the tent poles from that sacrifice are still stored here in the basement of the Masonic Manor. And this isn't like little stories. Can you imagine how many years ago, when the 1717 something? And they went to every confluence of every river because the Eastern religions believe that at the confluence of rivers is where is where there's the most spiritual activity. That's why in the Ganges River, they go into the Ganges River, even though it's filthy muddy, they go in there to be cleansed and all that, because right there, it's where they go into the Ganges is a confluence of two rivers. And somehow it goes back to the Garden of Eden and Adam and Eve and the two rivers of Euphrates and the two rivers that met at the Garden of Eden. And so it's creepy, but that was at the mouth of the Platte River, where the Platte goes in the Missouri River, just did this big sacrifice. And I thought, who knows anything about this? But I had a pastor from Scott's Bluff that brought a team of his people here, and we went down and prayed at the confluence because he'd heard that Lewis and Clark had done this Masonic, demonic activity at the mouth of the river. People don't know that. And we're in a battle. We're going to be down there Friday. Now you're rich, right? Yeah. We're going to be down there, and they're going to close off part of Main Street, and we're going to be singing gospel music, which the devil will hate for that to go on. And I don't want to bring glory to the enemy, because he that's in me is greater than he that's in this world. I'm seated in heavenly places above and beyond the principalities of this world. But the enemy will let the false churches flourish. He'll let the food, fun, and fellowship churches flourish. But if you're really battling, if you're really in the army of God, if you really want to be in the Lord's army, then there's a reality there's a reality in Christianity that we need to deal with. And you need to understand that. And it's not to be scared or be fearful. But, you know, like Anthony, he knows, he knew what the reality was. He was shot, almost killed. And there's a reality to this. And there's a reality. There's people battling in this time right now in our church. There's people that are battling diseases. There's people that are battling previous attacks in their lives. There's people that are battling various things. And what we have to realize is that we have a fight to fight. And we're either on the Lord's side, we're either doing His thing or we're not. We're either doing it or not. I don't know how serious you guys take the things that are going on in this world. I imagine you take it pretty serious in the Air Force, right? I mean, it's serious stuff. But probably also in that same Air Force, there's guys that are just in it because they want to get the education, they want to get the benefits, they don't have anything else to do with their life, so they went and did that, right? You know, but there's some people that are really understand that there's a war in this world going on. And it's a war against freedom, it's a war against peace, it's a war against the United States. And we just suffered that for the last 8 years of administration. The last 8 years, and now we're suffering with the media and the press that continually try and keep our leadership distracted from what they're supposed to do. It's ridiculous. I just, this week, and not to get too political, but this week I listened to the Comey testimonies, and I heard his actual testimonies, and then I saw the spin that the news media put on it. And they didn't match. They did not match at all. And both sides were claiming victory. You know, I heard President Trump's son speak on a radio program, and he said, yeah, we put this all to bed now. And the radio commentator said, I don't think they're going to let it live because this is a distraction, that they've got the American public distracted with this. And we can't get done what we're supposed to do. The enemy has us divided and confused. Remember, Lincoln said that together we stand, divided we fall. And we need to stand together. And right now, the enemy is trying to split the country, just like in the Civil War. Half the country is supporting the devil. And we've got to understand we're in a battle. So I would pray for Randy's group when they're coming this Friday. I would be there. I'd be walking the streets praying. I would be tearing down strongholds. I would be speaking against the devil. And I'd be praising the name of the Lord and lifting up the name of the Lord. Because He says, where I'm lifted up, then I'll draw them in unto Me. And so we'll lift up the name of the Lord. We'll rebuke the enemy. And have your guys pray on their 9-hour drive up here or whatever it is. They might be. Are they coming in separate cars? Are they coming in a bus? Or are they?
Yeah, probably a couple days.
What?
Separate.
Separate, okay.
Some might come late and some come late.
Okay. And they're all staying with you, or do you have places set up?
Yeah, the one that's coming is staying with you.
Oh, all right. Okay.
We got a big house.
You got a big house? Okay. Yeah, Tom knows all about the big house. But different big house, right? Yeah. Do they call that the big house, or is the Lincoln the big house?
Lincoln.
I think Lincoln's the big house, yeah. Okay. So he overcomes. And it's a real question. Christianity isn't this like put it in cruise and cruise through life. It's a reality. It's an absolute reality. Smyrna, the church admired for its tribulations and poverty, was forecast to suffer more persecution. And sometimes I feel like that's where we are. But their promise is, be faithful unto death, and I'll give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He overcomes shall not be hurt by the second death. The church of Pergamon, the church located at Satan's seat, needed to repent for allowing false teachers. It's ridiculous that they allowed false teachers to come into the church. But there's false teachers in churches all over today. There's false preachers. And Anthony didn't go into it, but he actually tried to become a Catholic priest, and they wouldn't allow it for whatever reason. But he thought that's where he was supposed to go. He thought that's what was supposed to happen. After he got shot, he went to the Catholic Church because it was the church nearest to where he was living at the time. And he thought that's where he was supposed to go. And I don't know if you heard, he was involved in it for 7 years. He really thought he was going someplace. And then it's like he saw the light. You know, and so there's false churches out there that are misleading people, terribly misleading people. And the enemy's sneaky. He's sneaky. But we have authority over him. We serve the Savior that crushed his head, that crushed the power. He has no power on this earth anymore. To him who overcomes, I'll give some of the hidden man to eat. I'll give him a white stone. We talked about the hidden man of the mystery of the Word of God that comes to us through the power of the Holy Spirit. Thyatira, the latter works are greater than the former. Held the teaching of a false prophet. Their latter works were greater than the former. They're growing. They're growing in their knowledge of God. They're growing in the works that they're doing. And yet they let Jezebel come in and run things. And this is bad. This is bad. This is, you know, I'll probably tick off some ladies for this, but if it's man's job to be the leader in the home, then it's sin for the lady to take over. And as a Christian lady, that's a sign of faith. That's a sign of faith. If you try and run your husband as a Christian lady, you're trying to do God's work. And if you're doing God's work, then he's not going to bless the union. He can't bless the union where the woman is trying to run things. And so I'm getting myself in trouble. But that's the whole thing. But let me say this. If it's man's job to make that final decision, and I'm not talking about, of course you discuss things and you make the wisest decisions between the two, but if it's the man's job to do that and the woman tries to do it, it's sin. But if it's the man's job and he doesn't do it, he doesn't have the boldness to stand up in his marriage and take his place. And I'm not talking about violence. I'm not talking about ridicule. I'm not talking about demeaning the other person. I'm talking about being responsible for the final decision, taking responsibility for the final decision. And sometimes that's difficult. I've been married 50 years, and sometimes I've made final decisions that haven't worked out right. And I know that it would be so easy for my wife to say, "I told you so." But praise God that she doesn't do that. But I know in so many marriages, it's almost like the wife is waiting for the man to make mistakes so she can say, "I told you so." But that's wrong. That man makes that decision, he's responsible for it, and he lives with the decision. So many men have become cowards. So many men have become cowards, and they let the wife make all the decisions. Oh, she makes that decision. Oh, she makes that decision. Oh, she makes that decision. And it's wrong. And the prophetess Jezebel, she was a manipulator. She would manipulate, just as Jezebel manipulated Ahab. She would manipulate, and the man might not even know that he's failing to lead his home. And so he should be leading his home in a religious aspect. He should be, and if he's not the religious leader in his home, he needs to study the Word and get in that position. He needs to get in that position because we're training kids. We're training these kids through our example of how these things should be done. Sardis, the church is known for their works by the world, and they seem to be alive, but they're dead. This is so many churches today. They got big buildings, they got great big, all kinds of activities, and they're famous on TV or whatever, but they're dead. They don't have that deep personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And I encourage you to have a deep personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Deeper than mine, I hope. Stronger than mine, I hope. Because I would like people to emerge out of this church as people that are really sold out to God. I would love to see people emerge as really sold out to God. And in their promise, he who overcomes will like them be dressed in white. I will never blot out their name from the book of life. You know, people believe in once saved, always saved. But there's a whole group of people in Matthew 7 that stand before Jesus, and he said, "I never knew you. I never knew you. I never knew you." You can paint whatever brush you want on that and say, "Oh, that's the Methodists, or that's the Lutherans, or that's the people that don't know him." But he said that these people stand before him and said, "Didn't we do this in your name? Didn't we do that in your name? Didn't we do that?" So these were people that were in a church where they spoke Jesus' name. These were people in a church that thought they were fighting demons, they thought they were praying for the sick to be healed. And he says, I never knew you. I never knew you because there wasn't that intimate relationship. There wasn't that intimate relationship. I don't know him. You know, I don't know who he is. And I don't want to be, I want him to say, come on in, Dad, this is Jim. Remember Jim? The guy that witnessed everybody he ran into and tried to share his faith with anybody he could share his faith with. And I'm not drawing attention to myself. I'm just saying, I want those kind of things to be said. I want him to say, well done, good and faithful servant. I want him to invite me in. And it's not works. It's not works. I'm saved by the blood of the Lamb. But I want to be that person that God says. And it's different for everybody. Maybe he says to one man, you know, well done, good and faithful servant. You did a good job of raising your daughters. You did a good job of raising your sons. You were a good example to them. You made the sacrifices to put them in Christian schools or whatever. You know, you did a good job of raising your daughters. You raised kids that want to praise God in relationship with God. So, you know, for me, it's the witnessing. For Anthony, it's the witnessing. For you, it may be how you live your life before people in an honorable way, an ethical way. It's different. That's why my sheep know my voice. They hear my voice. They come in and they go out. They come in and hear what God has for you to do, and you go out and do it. That's what Jesus says. Sardis is the church known for their works. But okay, so Philadelphia, the church steadfast in faith, and they kept God's word and endured patiently. Christ commended the church in Philadelphia for four things. They had an open door. They had little strength, and they were still doing stuff with their little strength. They had an open door. And they kept the word of God and they've not denied the Lord. You know, this is the church. He says, you're doing it all. You're doing it all. He said, you got an open door. In other words, your heart is open to anybody and everybody. You know, I don't know how people responded when they saw Anthony walk in today because he's a man of a different color than most of the people in this church. And people have different responses to that. But do you have an open door? He's my brother in Christ. He's my brother. I saw him in the grocery store. T-shirt says, Jesus saves. We're going to talk. You know, he's my brother. You know, and maybe closer as a brother in some aspects than my physical brother. But my physical brother loves the Lord too. So, but you see what I'm saying? He's my brother. Do I have an open door? Is my heart open to those people? Or is my heart open to others? They have a little strength. You know, and Jesus says, or Paul says, when I'm weak, then I am strong. It's at my weakest. It's what I'm doing that I don't have a clue what I'm supposed to be doing, that I allow Jesus to do it for me. When I get up here and preach, when I share my faith with other people, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm trusting in God to do that. I'm trusting God to do that. And I'll study the Word so I know the roadmap, but I'm often going places I've never gone before. And so I was humbled by the fact that every lady that walked by Anthony said, "Hi, Anthony." They knew him. Some of them knew him from his church, some of them knew him from his signs, some of them knew him from his van, his TV show, I don't know, but they knew him. And I was humbled. I said, "Lord, you know, do these people know me as a Christian? Do these people know me and recognize me?" And so I got to get me some of them orange shirts or something. I don't know. I'm gonna display the name of Jesus Christ. He gave me one of the shirts and... He gave me a couple of shirts I'm gonna bring up here next week and or the week after, and I'm gonna offer you some items. The trouble is they're all double X large and stuff. That'll fit me. So anyhow, you guys are going out of town if you want some. I got them in my car. I just didn't know what he was gonna do today, so I didn't bring them in. But God did. I was at Baker's. And I just bought a $50 gift card because it was free with my bank. Actually, it was more than free. I got $5 off my groceries, and it cost $4.95 for the card, right? A $50 MasterCard card. So I got out of the car after I talked to him, and we'd actually left to go get our grandson. We came back because he called me and said, "You want these t-shirts?" I said, "I'll be right back." So we went and got our grandson, came back. And he gives me this handful of t-shirts, which if you guys want one, just let me know. And And he gives me his handful of t-shirts, and I said, well, I want to give you something for him. He said, oh, no, no. He says, I don't need anything. I said, yeah. I said, there's something. So I get back to the car, and the Lord said, give him that $50 MasterCard charge, you know, to you can use it anywhere, anytime. So I went to the car, got it, it, you know, and so, you know, into his ministry, whatever he's doing, I don't care what he does with it, but I just did what God told me to do. And I'm a little strained. I don't have $50 to just hand somebody like that, but that's what I did. You know, so God does what he does. Their promise to him who overcomes, I will make a pillar of the temple of my God. Never again will he leave it. I will write on his name, the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which is going down to heaven from God, and I will also write on him my new name. Wow, that's just incredible. Just incredible. I want some pillar with my name on it in that new Jerusalem. Wouldn't that be nice? Wouldn't that be nice? Wow. But anyhow, so the the church of Laodicea, it's the lukewarm church. I don't know how far we'll get through it. But the angel of the church of Laodicea is like these things, says the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. Each time I talk to you about how Jesus is talking to them, he establishes a place in relationship with them. Each one of these, he established a place in his relationship with that church. And when I go back over them in a week or so, in 2 weeks, I'll emphasize that. But he said this. He says, these things says the Amen, the faithful, true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. In other words, he's saying, I have the authority to say what I'm going to say to you, Laodicea. I have the authority. Now, he's not taking that position in these other churches necessarily. He presented himself differently. But to the Laodiceans, he is going to talk to them straight up. It's like when you did something as a teenager and your dad, loving, caring dad, is always wonderful to you, and he catches you doing something and he comes down in your face. My dad was a military dad, and he came down in your face and you just felt like you needed to salute him or something and stand at attention, because he'd come down and he'd just get in your face. And he'd say, I'm your father, and I have the right and the authority to tell you what to do. And that's what Jesus is doing here to the church of Laodicea. He says, I'm going to get in your face, and I have the right to get in your face, because I'm the creator of the universe. I'm the faithful one. I'm the true one. I'm the true witness. I've seen what you're doing, and I'm going to get in your face. And it's a question of the church today, how do we receive that? We have this wonderful, you know, group hug, kumbaya God that we serve. And Jesus is all that. And we saw him present himself to the various churches that way. But when he came to the lukewarm church, he said, I'm getting in your face. I'm getting in your stuff, and I have the authority to get in your stuff. I know your works, that you're neither cold or hot. I would wish you were cold or hot. So then, because you're lukewarm, neither cold or hot, I'll vomit you out of my mouth. What a thing to say. I'm going to spit you out. I'm going to vomit you out. Now, what's interesting with this church, which you may have not known, depending on how much you've studied it, every one of these things that he talks to them about is relative to their city, relative to their church, relative to what's going on. Because you see, the church at Laodicea had a bad tepid water supply. The whole city did, not just the church. So they knew that he was talking to them. He knew that they were talking to him. He says, you're lukewarm. You're neither hot or cold. Now, there's two cities. There was hot water in Hierapolis, which was right next to there. And on the other side, up on the mountain, there was the cold water of Colossae, which is, you know, the mountain streams. So he says, I wish you were cold or hot, one of the two. He's talking to them. He's talking to them about their city. He's talking about the condition of their city. What's happened, Laodicea, is over here you've got hot water because of the volcanic activity near Hierapolis. Then over here you have cold water because of the beautiful mountain streams that come down through Colossae. But you've come to a place where you put up with this tepid water, this tepid, dirty water that you drink and that you live on. You think you see, the whole thing is they thought they were a hot shot city. And see, there's churches today that think they're hot shot churches because they get national attention. They get invited to Oprah or whatever else. They think they're hot shot stuff. But he's in their face. He says, you've become lukewarm. Don't be lukewarm. And it's not just lukewarm. The water was foul, dirty, and tepid. It was foul and dirty. They didn't have fresh water, hot water. At least you can make tea out of hot water. You can make a nice cold drink out of cold water. But where are you? Where are you, church? Where are you, church? Where are you as individuals? I'm speaking to you as individuals. He goes, where are you as individuals? What have you done with God? What have you done with your salvation? What have you done with Jesus Christ? What are you doing with Him? Where are you going with Him? What's happening in your life with Him? Is there substance in your life? Revelations 3:17. Because you say, I'm rich, I have become wealthy, I have need of nothing, and do not know that you're wretched, miserable, poor, and blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may see. I want to stop here for a second, then I'm going to go on, I'm going to show you the irony of what he's saying to them. I'm going to show you the irony of what he's saying. He said, you say you're rich. This is a sarcastic statement. Jesus, God rarely makes a sarcastic statement throughout the Bible. It's rare. But he's making a sarcastic statement, and you'll see why in a second. You say you're rich? You think you're rich, America? You think you're richer than the rest of the world, America? I let you gain that wealth so you could spread the gospel throughout the whole world. And up until the 1960s or so, you were doing that. You were defending freedom on foreign soil. You were going places. You were giving your life both in missionary and for freedom so that the gospel could be carried into these countries. But somewhere along the line, you got inbred. And you just Christianity is now a food, fun, and fellowship, a gathering, a kumbaya thing. You're no longer soldiers. You've lost it. I don't know if God even speaks to America anymore. I don't know if God's speaking to these teenagers that just ignore Him, these young people that just ignore Him. I don't know. I don't know if God is speaking to these people anymore. I hope so. But He says, I won't strive with you forever. He said, you're wretched, miserable, poor, and blind. By the world standard, we're the greatest place. We're the hotshot country. America is, wow, this is the place to be. But I'll tell you something, unless we turn back, and I'm not the carrier of bad news, unless we turn back, and it's not that God's mad at us. God loves us with an everlasting love. He sent Jesus because He loved us so much. He came in the person of Jesus Christ to show us His sacrifice for His love. He didn't come in the world to condemn the world. But He said in Genesis, the reaping and sowing, the sowing and reaping, the seasons are going to go on until the end of time. Until Christ returns, what you sow, you reap, whether you like it or not. What you sow, you reap. And I tell you what, if you're sowing things that you shouldn't be sowing, that I jump in and I break the curses that the enemy has now got an open door to attack you. You're miserable, poor, and blind, and you're naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in fire. He's saying, I got real gold. I got real gold. Do you think you're rich? I got real gold. My real gold is the things that change lives. My real gold is the things that causes you to share your faith. My real gold is a dedication to Jesus Christ. My real gold is an intimate relationship with God. That's the real gold. The real gold is a love. You remember I told you when Anthony was talking, those who are forgiven much or love much, remember the lady comes in to the Pharisee's house while Jesus has been invited to the Pharisee's house, and this prostitute comes in, and she starts to weep, and she her tears fall on His feet. She uses her hair to wipe up. She says, don't you know who He is? What's wrong? This guy's supposed to be a prophet. Doesn't he know who she is? And he says to her, you know what? Those who are forgiven much love much. And I wonder if we have a perspective of the greatness of the forgiveness that each one of us have. Each one of us might say, well, I'm a pretty good person. I've not done much that needs to be forgiven. But the fact that you ignored God until the day you got saved, the fact that you snubbed your nose at His Son who gave His life for you, you better love a lot. You better love a lot. And that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness might not be revealed. You know what? It'd be great if, you know, America hid behind the cross for 200 years. It'd be great if we get behind the cross again. We were protected. We were protected until, and you know, we didn't see destruction on our soil until the bombing at the Twin Towers. You know why that is? Because there was an open door. There was an open door because our nakedness was so exposed. Our nakedness had been being exposed the last 8 years. Our nakedness was exposed to the world. We bowed before Saudi leaders, Saudi kings. We went and bowed. And you said, well, I didn't bow. Yeah, your president represents you. You went and bowed. Our nation bowed before that king. That king. That king has got nothing but desert and oil. That's all he's got is desert oil. He's got all the money. He's got poverty all over the place. And people line up by the thousands every day for him to say, oh, give that one, you know, a little money. Give that one a little money. Like he's some sort of God. Our nakedness was hidden from the world. They didn't know. But now our nakedness is being exposed. Vietnam, our nakedness was exposed. We weren't as tough as we thought we were. Because we had mixed will about the fight. We could have gone in there and slaughtered that whole thing and straightened that all out, and they'd be free people today. But now they're ruled by communist China and communists because of what? Because we had mixed emotions about it. Why did we have mixed emotions about it? Because we had kids at Kent State and places like that demonstrating against it. Because the kids that had gone and said at 17, I'm going to World War II, I'm going to Omaha Beach, I'm gonna be shot at, I'm gonna be struck, I'm gonna be probably killed, never get to come back home, but I'm gonna fight. I'm gonna fight for this nation because it's worth fighting for. And that's been exposed. After the wall fell down, and I'm almost done, after the wall fell down, they asked the Russian soldiers what was their biggest fear of American soldiers. They said the biggest fear of American soldiers is they all think they're the star of the movie. And they said, what do you mean they all think they're the star of the movie? Yeah, they all think that everybody else is going to get shot and killed, that they're going to be the one, and they just keep coming, and they keep coming, and they keep coming. Even though they saw other people fall by side, they never think that they're going to fall, and they'll fight, and they'll fight. And they said, we don't have a cause like that. They have a cause that they'll fight to the death for, believing that they're the ones that are going to win. And see, there's a mentality with winning. There's a mentality, and the enemy wants to think you're a loser, but I can do all things through Christ. And anoint your eyes with eyesight that you may see. Let me flip this real quick and look what's going on. Laodicea was a wealthy town that was known as a strategic banking center. See what he says? You think you're rich? You know what the value of wealth is based on in the world today? The dollar. The dollar, everything is the dollar. They've tried to change it, China's tried to change it, Putin's tried to change it and move it from the dollar. But it's the dollar. And it's no longer attached to gold, you know, that our dollar worth is based on oil value now. So as the value of oil goes up and down, that affects the value of the dollar. Because it's based on oil, not gold. They were a banking center. So he says, you think you got gold? I'll show you gold. Gold is a changed heart. Gold is a person dedicated to their relationship with God. Gold is not what you think it is. They used their own wealth to pay for reconstruction city after the devastating earthquake in AD 60, rejecting an offer of the financial aid from Rome. They were so proud, they said, we don't want your money, Rome, to rebuild our city after this devastating earthquake. We'll use our own money. Who's that sound like? Go on. They weren't humble, obviously. Laodicea was a great center for manufacturing clothing. The sheep which grazed around Laodicea were famous for their soft black wool that they produced. They were famous for the soft black wool they produced. And what did Jesus say? I'll give you white robes. I'll give you white rooms, because your nakedness is not hidden by this black wool. Isn't it interesting that it wasn't just wool, it was a famous black wool that they covered themselves with, and they were famous for exporting that to the rest of the world. And ancient medicine, particularly eye salve, isn't that funny that they made a special eye salve? They made a special eye salve that they exported to Egypt. And it was valued because in Egypt the sands were so bad, the winds were so bad, that people's eyes would burn. They'd have to cover up everything so they couldn't hardly see, barely see out of it. And they had developed some sort of ancient medicine that this eye salve healed the burning eyes that the Egyptians had. And they were making money hand over fist by sending this eye salve to Egypt. Now, is this ironic? Jesus said, you know what? I can get in your face. I can get in your face. I'm going to get in your face, and I'm going to be sarcastic about getting in your face. When is God going to get sarcastic about getting in our face? I believe that he's sarcastic in getting in our face over what's been going on with the Islam's invading our country, Islam invading Europe. You think you're so sharp, Paris, France? You think you're so in control of things? I'll show you in control. There's whole neighborhoods you can't even go to. The police won't even go to because of the Islamic influence in those neighborhoods. There's people that have had to forfeit their homes. They couldn't even sell them because nobody would buy them. In Paris. And it's now moving to Europe, and they tried to stop it with Brexit. They're trying to stop it with Brexit, but now they're all confused and messed up. They don't know what they're doing. They just had a vote. They thought they'd bring in all the conservatives, and it just backfired completely on them. What's going to happen here? When's God going to come down and he's going to put his finger in our face and say, I'm going to get in your face, and I have the right to get in your face. Because I'm the King of Kings, I'm the Lord of Lords, I'm the creator of this place. You're rich because I chose you to be rich. Why are we here? Why are we in some third world country eating lizards and on a bonfire in the backyard, never getting fresh water, never getting a bath? Why are we here? What made us special that we're here? What made us special is that our forefathers and our parents and grandparents, they served to whatever extent they understood. They served Jesus Christ. And I'll tell you what, we're going to lose it all. We're going to lose it all for our own kids and our own grandkids if we don't begin to serve Jesus Christ. If we don't start to stand up for our Lord Jesus Christ, if we don't proclaim his name in public, then he'll have every right to come down and say, I'm going to get in your face. So he says, I'll give you eye salve. Right? Go back. Go forward, and you'll see as I go back. There were three industries, finance, wool, and eye salve, came into play in the letter. So look again at what Jesus is saying to him. And we're going to close in just a second. Because you say, I'm rich, and have become wealthy, and have need of nothing, do not know that you're wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. America, the young people today think they got it made. They think they got it made. They got their smartphones. They've got their comfortable life. They live in mom and dad's house or mom and dad's basement. Or they got themselves a nice apartment. They got themselves a decent job. Somewhat of an education. They think they're cooking on high. In reality, they're poor, they're miserable, they're blind, and they're naked. And it's going to come back again. It's going to come back again. And they don't recognize it at all. They don't recognize it at all. They think this is America and we're on cruise and everything's going to be fine. If they had seen how bad America's become in the generation that I've lived in, if they've seen where we've gone from Leave It to Beaver to murder and mayhem and and shows about Dracula and vampires and we used to watch Leave It to Beaver. We watched the Nelsons. We watched Fathers Knows Best. We watched Roy Rogers. The Cisco Kid. They couldn't play, what's the Dodge Street Marshall deal or whatever that show was. They couldn't play that until after 9 o'clock at night on TV because it was too violent for kids. Do you know that? And now, oh my God. I mean, even when I just try and watch the news, all the commercials are about what the living dead and these zombies and just, oh, it's just sick. Just absolutely sick. What we've evolved to. We got freedom. We got freedom. We can live with somebody and not be married to them. We can do all these things. We got freedom. But see, what they don't recognize is they're blind, they're miserable, and they're poor. And God, who gave it to us, has every right to take it from us. He's not mad at us, and he's not going to take it in the sense that people say, oh, he caused Katrina and stuff. No, you know what causes that? Sin causes that. You know what causes climate change? Not our use of fuel. What causes climate change is sin. It impacts the whole earth. It changes the earth. It changes the chemistry of the earth. That's why it says in Romans, the whole earth groans for that day Jesus Christ will come back again. Let's keep, you know, it's all there. You see the things. You see everything there. Jesus hit on every one of them. You read through these things in the cute little Bible stories. You don't see what's going on. You need to study the Word of God. You need to see what He's trying to say to you. Could Jesus say the same thing to the Church of America today? Could He say the same thing to the Church of America today? You think you're so hotty-totty? You think you're so fancy? You think you're so great? He is saying the same thing to the church today because this word speaks to us as well as it did then. And when I bring them all together in a couple of weeks, you'll see how that all plays down. Revelations 3:19, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. He loves us. He loves us. He loves us, and we're going to reap what we sow. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Turn and get excited about God. Turn and get excited about what Jesus Christ has done for us. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. People use this all the time as a witnessing tool, but he's not talking to the lost, he's talking to the saved. He said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in and dine with them and enter with me. You know what that says? That doesn't say that, oh, I'm not saved and I need to ask Jesus into my life. I mean, it's a nice spin on it. But he's talking to the church. He's talking to the church and he says, you know what? I'm outside. I'm outside and you won't let me in. I've been knocking on the door. I'm outside and you won't let me in. I knocked on the door when the Twin Towers fell. I knocked on the door when we've been proclaimed as no longer a Christian nation. He says, I've been knocking on the door. When are you going to let me in? When are you going to let me back in, America? I'll come in and dine with him and he with me. See, part of the problem of not letting him in is we don't want him in. We don't want to dine with him. We don't want to spend time with him. We got other stuff to do. We're too busy. So he's knocking at the door. Come on, let me in because I want to give you the stuff that's true. I want to give you the stuff that's real. I want to give you the stuff that's really life-changing. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne. He says that in Ephesians, right? You're seated next to him. He's sitting next to the Father in heavenly places. We're seated next to Jesus Christ. He says, I'll let you sit with me on my throne as I overcame and sat down at my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear, the Spirit says to the churches. You know what he's promising us? He's promising us a place of authority. And it's promised to every Christian who wants to sit next to Jesus Christ in authority over the principalities and powers of this world. He wants us to sit there with him. But he's knocking on the door and saying, come on, let me in. Come on, let me in. Let me into your life. Let me into your day-to-day activities. Let me in. Please let me in. We'll sit down and we'll spend some time together. And then when we spend that time together, then I can give you that place of authority. Yeah, I don't know if you remember well enough, but I remember my dad saying, he says, son, you can have these keys to the car when I know I can trust you with the keys to the car. I said, well, how do you know you trust me with the keys to the car? And he says, well, I said, if I'm not driving, how do you know you trust me with the keys to the car? He says, I'll tell you how I know I can trust you with the keys to the car. By your actions. By how you present to yourself, how you behave. Jesus says to us, you want to sit on the throne of power over the enemy? Then let me see what your relationship is. Let me see where you're going with this. Let me see your hunger for the word. Let me see your desire to be in relationship with me. Then I'm going to give you the keys. I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom. I'm going to give you the keys that I took from Satan over death and the grave. I'm going to give you the keys. But first I want to see if the relationship is there. I just want to see if the relationship is there. What do I have to do to get your attention? What do I have to do to get you to desire the Word of God? What do I have to do? Not me, I'm talking about Jesus. He said, what do I have to do? What becomes important enough to you that you lay other things aside and say, you know what? This is what's important to me. This is what's important to me. Father, I praise you. I thank you. And I give you all the glory. I thank you for our visit with Anthony. I thank you for this day. I thank you for your message to the church of Laodicea. I thank you, Father God, that your word will not fall void, but it will go forth to do what it's called to do. That your word will go into each heart that's in this room, Father God. And you will change them by your word. There'll be miraculous changes. I trust that, Father God. I believe in that because I know that your Holy Spirit is powerful, that your word is sharper than a two-edged sword, and it'll get right down to the meat of things. It'll get right down to the bone of things. It'll get right down to where our life is manufactured, the very core of our bones, that it'll get down that far. Thank you, Father God, for your word. Thank you for the truth. Thank you for these people. Thank you for them coming and listening. Father God, thank you for the heart and desire to talk the word of God. And we'll praise you and give you glory in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Okay, thank you. Praise God.